Indeed, you are awesome in this place. Thank you, David. Thank you, Liz. Good morning. Grace and peace to you in the name of the risen Christ. Good morning, Cathedral of Hope, United Church of Christ. What a joy to, well, that was not bad.
I know. Huh? I thought I'd have to maybe encourage it a little more, but you did great. Good job, you. It's just, you know, it's a week, holiday weekend.
I know. There's so many people who are traveling this weekend, but we were so glad that.
Or sleeping at all. I don't know.
I don't know. Whatever they're doing. But we are so glad that you are in this place this morning. Welcome to each and every one of you. Thank you for being present. Your presence, it really is a gift to us. So thank you. It's great to see you this morning.
And if you're a first-time visitor, we would love to meet you. I am out in the Ministry and Visitor Center. After worship, we have a little gift for you. We want to get to know you and make sure that you have all your questions answered. Well, not all of them, but whatever we can do for you here at the church, love to meet you after the worship service.
And as always, we want to extend a very special welcome to all those who are worshiping with us online. And we know that there are probably more online this weekend because so many of our own congregation are out traveling. And I know that because I follow so many of you on Facebook, and I know exactly where you are, wherever you are around the town. So
he is a lurker. It just happens.
It's that private stalker. Yes. But it really is a joy to welcome. Let's welcome all those who are worshiping with us online this morning.
You're in your PJs with your mimosa. Just have fun with us.
Yes, they will. They will have fun with us this morning. Erin, I think we have a lot of announcements that are in our order of worship.
Well, the first thing that you should know is tomorrow we actually get a day off. The office is closed due to the holiday weekend. So if you have a question, which I know you all do because you're all coming to the Bad Girls, Bad Boys Bible study, correct? Yes, just say yes. Just say yes. It starts on Tuesday, and it's 7 o'clock in the choir room. Isabel and I, Pastor Isabel and I, are going to lead this class. We are so excited. It's going to be 8 weeks. You don't need to come to all of them. We'd love to have you. We are going to alternate between bad boys and bad girls. We're starting off this week with Eve. Ooh, the ultimate bad girl. And so Isabel and I like to think we're the bad girls of Cathedral of Hope, teaching you all about the bad boys and bad girls of the Bible. So join us this Tuesday. It's going to be a lot of fun.
And then coming up very, very soon, of course, is not only the kickoff to Pride, which will start here at Cathedral of Hope with a fabulous, amazing Power of One concert that you will not want to miss. And you can find out more information about that in the weekly. But then, of course, on the 18th of September is Pride itself. And we are inviting every single one of you to walk with us, to be a part of Pride. We have so many wonderful things that are happening on that day, to be a witness in our community and to share the unique, wonderful perspective that who Cathedral of Hope is. So we have some special giveaways that we're going to be...
and I don't know about you, I'm hot right now. I'm
it's
a little...
It's really warm.
Ooh, Mama's
really
hot. Warm. Let's see if we have anything. Ooh. I can't do that. You did so well. Yeah, sorry. I'm not Isabel. I don't. Okay, we're not going to... It just doesn't work that way. But aren't these lovely? If you sign up... Today only, just kidding, anytime you sign up. We're gonna give these away, and this is going to be a part of our parade. We're gonna do a whole dance. It'll be fun, so just sign up.
Woo. So yeah, do sign up.
Do sign up. I'm gonna keep this all day. This is good. This is so good.
You can find out a lot more information on page 6 of your weekly today. Also on page 8, want to remind you that Black Tie is coming up. We want to invite you to sign up if you're indeed possible to participate in Black Tie and to sit at one of our tables. It really is important. I can't overstress the importance. If you are able to go to Black Tie and to be on one of our tables, we obviously need to meet our quota in order that we then get our part back of all of that fundraising. Last year, we received nearly $40,000 from the Black Tie event, and so we want to make sure that we meet our quotas. So please do check out information. It's on page 8 of your weekly, and also you can sign up today in the Narthex, and please see Leslie Fry, who has much, much more information for you.
And in page 9 of your weekly, we are going to be participating in the AIDS Arms Life Walk. How many of you have been a part of the Meemaw Walkers?
Yeah, there's a lot
of love saying Meemaw. I want to say it all the time. I hear she's a good girl.
She is.
So amazing. Starting next Sunday and for the next following few Sundays, there'll be a chance for you to sign up to raise money for this important, important event. It gives money back to us for our Evelyn Pruitt AIDS Crisis Fund. And so we'd love to have you participate. Please start signing up next Sunday and look out for that.
And please check out page 7 of your weekly. You'll find a lot more information about Take the Power. It's an estate planning seminar. But if there is any one of you in this congregation who wants to make a difference beyond the life of who we are as individuals, as human beings, this really is an opportunity for you to come and check out all of the ways in which you can support Cathedral of Hope beyond just the Sunday offerings on a Sunday. So please do take a look at that. It's on September the 11th at 12:30 in the Interfaith Peace Chapel, which of course is our building just outside the main building here. You can register today either through our website or in person. As many of you know, one of the things that we have been launching is a $5 million in 5-year campaign through legacy and through pledges to build that legacy so that the Cathedral of Hope lasts long beyond any single one of us. And so we're going to invite you to do that. I will have some exciting information for you in the next few weeks about where we are on that 5 million in 5 years campaign that was started last year. And I'll have some exciting information for you in the next few weeks about where we are in that campaign. So please take note of that. And please, if you're able to, go to the seminar on September the 11th at 12:30. Today, Pope Francis will be canonizing Mother Teresa as a saint. That's a really good thing.
Right? So exciting.
This ceremony will highlight the Pope's ideal of a poor church for the poor that pays special attention to the developing world. Mother Teresa, an ethnic Albanian born in 1910 in what is today the Republic of Macedonia, joined an Irish order of nuns at the age of 18 and taught the order's schools in India. Moved by the poverty and famine she had witnessed, she left to found the Missionaries of Charity in what is today known as Calcutta, India, with 12 followers in 1950. Today, her order has more than 5,600 members and runs orphanages, hospices, homes for pregnant women and the mentally ill, and other services in 139 countries. Mother Teresa died at the age of 87 in 1997. In the 1990s, the work of Mother Teresa with the poor and marginalized was strongly influential in the development of Cathedral of Hope's outreach ministries to precursors to our BARC, Breakfast at Cathedral of Hope, and iCare Benevolence Ministries. Her example reminds us how one individual who allows the living spirit of Christ to guide their life can change the world for the better. We invite you today to take a moment to visit the statue of Mother Teresa in our Hall of Heroes following our worship today. Let's congratulate Mother Teresa. Friends of Christ, now as we gather in this place, let us share in that hope, one with each other. Let's rise and greet one another in Jesus' name.
pray. O God of many names, come to us. Send your wild and beautiful spirit to be with us. Open our hearts, open our minds to hear your beautiful words today. In the name of Jesus, amen.
Hear these words. Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and the sea was no more. And I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, beautiful as a couple on their wedding day. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, "See, the home of God is among mortals. God will dwell with them. They will be God's people, and God will be fully present among them. And God will wipe away every tear from their eyes, and death will be no more. Mourning and crying and pain will be no more, for the former things have passed away." And one who was seated on the throne said, "See, I am making all things new," and added, "Write this, for these words are trustworthy and true." May God bless the hearing of these ancient words. Amen. Amen.
Friends, how blessed we are. Every single Sunday, our music department pulls it out for us and reminds us of how the Spirit connects to our lives and how the Spirit connects to our souls. And I'm so appreciative of the work that our orchestra and our choir and our music department does here at Cathedral of Hope. I'm also very appreciative of the work that they do in other parts of this community, especially those who sing with organizations like Resounding Harmony and also with the Turtle Creek Chorale. And this past weekend, the Turtle Creek Chorale recruited four of our choir members to sing with them at the Turtle Creek Chorale. I will say, when I prayed with them this morning, I did warn those new members of the Turtle Creek Chorale that being in a concert on a Saturday night does not mean that they can't be here on Sunday morning. So we will hold that in prayer, especially if Sean can be here on Sunday, then everybody else can be, amen? Then let's come together in prayer with our brothers and sisters this morning. God, how grateful we are. Grateful for the way in which this community of faith is not just about being Cathedral of Hope, but enables the ministry of this church to reach other organizations in our city, in our state, and around the world. Thank you for the way in which we commission ourselves as sisters and brothers and as friends with Christ to be of relevance in our world and in our community. Thank you, God, for bringing us to this place this day so that we can share in community one with the other through our places of need and through our places of ministry. We think specifically of those within our congregation who are traveling on this Labor Day weekend. And we ask, God, that you would bless them wherever they are, that it may be a time of renewal and refreshment, that if they're journeying, that you would provide for them safe travels. We ask, God, that you would bring them safely home to us at this place so that we might again join together in friendship and fellowship one with the other. And for each and every one of us who's gathered in this place this morning, we pray that you would be with us at our place of need. Whatever that is that we have come with this morning, perhaps we've come with a need to be supplied by your Spirit. Perhaps we are in need of healing or wholeness. Perhaps we're just needing a place that we might celebrate our joy that refreshes our soul. Wherever we are on that continuum, God, we know that you will not disappoint us, that if we open ourselves to your Holy Spirit, you will remind us again and again that you are with us. So it's in that place of thanksgiving, in that place of grace, in that place of healing, in that place of wholeness that we open ourselves now in this time of worship. And through all that we think and all that we say, we pray that they may send a blessing into the world. For we know that there are many places in this world that need your blessing. And that blessing is not just something that comes from on high. That blessing is something that we have to give. So help us to be those givers of your blessing, the light in the darkness, a place of salt in the earth, that we may be those movers and those shakers, those transforming spirits of Christ, as you encourage us as the hands and the feet and the arms and the legs, the very embodiment of Christ within us. You call us forth in this moment to know that we are more than conquerors with Jesus Christ at the heart of our values and our purpose. So we send out those tentacles that see no borders, that see no boundaries, and that see that all things are possible with you. May we go forth in the courage and the commitment and the passion that you have afforded to us this day, so that this world might become that new heaven and that new earth that you prophesied of in the book of Revelation. May we be reminded that all things are new this day, and that all things work together for good for those who love our God. So bringing our hearts and our minds and our thoughts together in the words that are spoken and the words that are unspoken, you presented to those early disciples a prayer, a roadmap, if you will, of what prayer can look like as we give our thanksgiving to you. So join with us now as we sing together the prayer that Jesus taught us. Our Creator.
God be with you.
And also with you.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Luke.
Glory to you, O God.
Once Jesus was asked by the Pharisees when the realm of God was coming, and he answered, "The realm of God is not coming with things that can be observed, nor will they say, 'Look, here it is,' or 'There it is.' For in fact, the realm of God is within you." This is the gospel of hope.
I'm going to invite you to be seated, and if you would once again open your hearts and your minds as we ask God to bless this word this morning, let us pray. Almighty, gracious, and overwhelming God, the Spirit that always shows up as we invite that Spirit into this place and into each and every one of our lives, open us now as co-creators with you, O God, to the God who is still speaking. The God who is still present, this God who still has relevance for our world and for our church. Open us so that our spirits might collide with yours, O God, and the revelation might be revealed. Open us, O God, to that Spirit that speaks to the inner still voice within us and causes us to be transformers in this world. And now, O gracious one, I pray that you would touch my lips of clay, mold them into the words that need to be spoken this day. And may the words that come from my mouth and the meditations on each and every one of our hearts, may they be ever acceptable to you. In the name of Jesus, the risen Christ, in whom we pray. Amen. So this morning we begin a new sermon series called Vibrant, Inclusive, and Progressive, VIP. It was a phrase that we began using, or I began using in the church when I first came here just over a year ago, and began to think about what is Cathedral of Hope, or who is Cathedral of Hope, or what is it that Cathedral of Hope is inspired to be for this generation and for the generations to come. And we celebrate, and we celebrated today, the fact that Cathedral of Hope, a 46-year-old congregation, has been a pioneering force within the world. It's been a pioneering experience, perhaps even an experiment, of what Christianity can look like for a new generation. And we began to think about who we are for the next generation, with great thanks for who we have been over the last 46 years, giving God great thanks for the way in which the ministry of Cathedral of Hope has transformed the world. And you might be sitting here this morning and asking ourselves, how on earth did a congregation here in Dallas, Texas, transform the world? Well, I want to tell you how Cathedral of Hope has transformed the world. If it had not been for the ministry of Cathedral of Hope, there would not be open and affirming congregations in every conceivable denomination around the world. Give thanks for what God is doing. I celebrate over and over again about the wonderful ways in which God has used congregations like the Cathedral of Hope. My good friend, Reverend Tori Topchin, is here this morning. He was a colleague of mine in Los Angeles and now is a minister, the pastor of Milwaukee Metropolitan Community Church. And he, you know, here is Wisconsin, you know, the land of beer and cheese. I learned that this weekend. And he was telling me about how he's beginning to gather together a whole group of people who want to talk together about being a progressive community in Wisconsin. what it means in Milwaukee to be a place of vibrancy. And he was sharing with me that he has been receiving emails over the last few weeks from clergy of nearly every conceivable denomination wanting to come together and to talk about how they can be in partnership one with the other. And I'm so proud, not only of his ministry, but I'm really proud of the way in which our United Church of Christ sisters and brothers and clergy have been gathering together to think about what it means to be a community of faith and to be in collaboration with one another. That's what it means to be living the gospel of Jesus Christ. Here we are, sisters and brothers, a vibrant, inclusive, and progressive community, or VIP, as I like to call it. Because we really are VIPs. We are not just vibrant, inclusive, and progressive, but according to the word of Jesus Christ, we are also very important people. We're important people on a mission, not to make us look great, but to make God look awesome. We're on a very important progressive ministry to reclaim Christianity and to put the Christian church back, just as those in our past have come together to bring about a revolution in Christianity and Christian thought. So we, as Cathedral of Hope, are being called as vibrant, inclusive, and progressive to put the Christian church back to where it should be, to focus on Jesus Christ, to focus on what it means to be a follower of Jesus, to refocus and reshape our lives into the very values of who Jesus is. And that is good news, not just for those of us who have been excluded from churches for one reason or another, but it's really good news for the Christian church together. It really is good news as we build a vibrant community, a place of vibrancy, a place of service, a place that people want to show up on a Sunday morning, not a place where people feel obligated to show up on a Sunday morning. How many of us have lived under the thought that you're obligated to be in church on Sunday morning? Well, I give praise for the guilt that you went under. But I want to build a congregation where we want to be in church on a Sunday morning. We want to be here. We want to be here because this is where the action is. This is where God is. This is the place where we come together so that we might be encouraged for the rest of the week. It's the place where we seek out the Spirit's teaching and we seek out the Spirit's presence. It's a place where everybody is talking about across town. Oh, have you heard what's going on at that Cathedral of Hope over there? God is doing a new thing. That's what we heard about in the book of Revelation, a book that was written several thousands of years ago. And it was written to encourage the church then, and it's written to encourage us today. Reverend Erin inspired me just a few weeks ago when she called for the offering, and she used this particular passage to remind us that the book of Revelation, whilst we sometimes look at that book and we think, oh, that's a little bit spooky, there's some strange things in that book of Revelation, but she reminded each and every one of us that the book of Revelation is really a dance between God and the church. It's a dance about talking about what this new heaven and new earth might look like. It's a dance that's been given to us to encourage us and to cause a passion within us, a passion to know that Christ is still present in the church if we allow Christ to be present in the church. There are many places where we've not allowed Christ to be present. But in our church this morning, we allow Christ to be present so that we might build a vibrant community. And this new heaven and this new earth that the writer of this revelation is talking about is calling us to remain firm to the values of what Jesus came to preach, to remain consistent in our thoughts, to remain consistent in our actions, and to be reminded that this dance between heaven and earth, that place where God is and the place where humanity dwells, that this dance that we are involved in is a dance that we get to do together. That's why we call ourselves co-creators with God. It means that God is still creating this place, but God is relying on each and every one of us to be the hands and the feet and the legs and the arms of Christ in the world today. You see, Christianity is not about bricks and mortar. Christianity is not about how big the building is or even how beautiful the building is, and I'm so grateful that Cathedral of Hope has both big and beautiful, but that realistically Christianity is about how we live our lives beyond the bricks and mortar of a building. Christianity is about building a vibrant community so that we might be change makers in the world, knowing that wherever we touch, whatever we speak to, whatever we look like, whatever we live like, is a testimony to the presence of Christ in our lives, and that we should be like that sweet perfume that permeates every piece of life. I think I told you this story, and I'm going to tell you it again, but when I was a minister in Bournemouth, England, we shared a building with Unity Fellowship. And that particular congregation within the particular building was a great place to worship. And I'd been the pastor there for maybe a couple of years, and the Unity Church called a new pastor. And that new pastor came from California, surprise, surprise. And she crossed the pond the other way, and she came over to Bournemouth, England, and she was the pastor of that congregation. And when I first met her, there was something about her, not just about her spirit, but she would wear this perfume. And perhaps you've met people like this, and perhaps we're one of them. But she wore this perfume that when you gave you a hug, not only did you smell it, but you smelled it for 12 hours afterwards. Now, sometimes that's a good thing, and sometimes it's not such a good thing, but that's what it means to be a vibrant community. It means that wherever we have touched, God and the people we've touched know that we have been in their presence for years and months and days and hours later, hopefully with a sweet smell. And with that sweet odor of what it means to be in the passion of Christ, each and every one of us have the potential to be that person. Never underestimate what one person can do to change the world. That's why we honor Mother Teresa this morning. She was one person who changed the world. She allowed the place and the holy to be within her, saw a need within the world, and then she, instead of saying, "Well, I wonder who will do that," she showed up because the vibrant presence of Christ was within her, and she changed the world. That's why she's being sainted today. It's why Pope Francis, who has a passion for the poor, is sainting her within the Roman Catholic structure. And it's why we have a statue of Mother Teresa in our church to remind us that it takes just one person, to remind us that God can use us wherever we are in our lives, and that God can use us to make a difference. That's what it means to build a vibrant church, to build a vibrant community. It's not just what we do here on a Sunday morning, although what we do on a Sunday morning is incredibly blessed. It's what we do beyond this experience that makes the difference. It's will people look at our lives and say, "There is something about you that I want to make real in my life." And then it's our responsibility to remind ourselves that it's not really about me. It's about the Holy Spirit that dwells in our lives. It's about the Holy Presence that inspires us to be these things and to be on fire for the presence of God to rule again in this place. And in that experience, all people will be drawn to this place. Not because of what we say necessarily, but because of what we do. It's what we are called to be a light in the world, to shape this reclaiming of Christianity so that it's not about a religion of dogma, but it's about a lifestyle choice that we get to put on, just like we put on that sweet cologne, to put it on every single day, in the good moments and in the not so good moments, to put it on just like we were put on a garment. And just like putting things on, we get the choice every single day whether we're going to put it on or take it off. I believe that the scriptures of our founding ancestors reminds us to put it on every single day and in every single situation. And even in those moments when we are so tempted not to be Christ-like, no, none of us in here have ever had those moments in our lives. But even in those moments when we are tempted to be less than Christ-like, to pause and stop for a moment and say, "How can I transform this situation? How can I transform this moment? How can I transform myself in order that the world might see Christ through me?" I believe that we are called as a vibrant community to first transform ourselves before we can transform anything else. It starts with that individual responsibility about who we are and how much commitment we are giving to our existence and our presence and our relationship with Jesus. How much attention are we placing? For if anyone knows anything about life, we know that where our attention is, it will grow. If our attention is to good things will grow. But how many of us have known that when our attention is placed on negative things, negativity also grows? Vibrancy, vibrant community, vibrant church is about being in the place of the holy right now and right in this moment. So that spirit can transform us, that spirit can overwhelm us, that spirit, as I said in that prayer, can collide with us. I love that. I love the fact that the spirit collides with us this morning. Because when everything collides with one another, it just goes all over the place. I believe that's what God is doing in this church this day, is colliding with us so that we might reach the entire world. Isn't that what we have been called to do in the Great Commission? To go into all the nations and preach the good news and to bring them to a place of faith. A faith that is theirs, not a faith that is ours. A faith that allows each and every person to meet God where they are on their journey. And then to create this new heaven and this new earth. Cathedral of Hope, we are building a vibrant church. A church that has its tentacles in every aspect of this city, every aspect of this state, and every aspect of this world, so that we might reclaim Christianity and allow people the love and the compassion and the kindness and the joy and the spirit that lives within them to come forth in their lives, just as it has come forth in ours this morning. I sincerely hope and pray that we are on a journey to build that vibrant community. How many of you are with me this morning to build a vibrant community? And don't worry if you're not ready to sign up for that. We'll get you signed up by the end of this sermon series. But join with me and with each and every one of us on this journey of faith to build a vibrant church. A vibrant community that is beyond the bricks and mortar, beyond the walls of this church, beyond even the experience that we've had as church for 46 years, to go into the places that no other place has yet touched. Just like Mother Teresa, who touched those who were untouchable, she allowed her life to know that all things work together for good, that she could be a vessel that God would use. May we go into every life situation believing that. And when people say thank you, then I ask you, like I ask myself, to always redirect people to the one who made that happen in your life, to the author and creator of our faith and the author and perfecter of our lives, to the God who is with us. May God honor us and bless us as we go now, ready after communion and after the closing song and the benediction. As we go out into the world, reminding us, as I try to at the benediction, to say to one another, our worship has ended, but our vibrant service to the world has just begun. God bless you, Cathedral of Hope.
Time where we begin our registration. If there is a red book at the end of your pew or chairs, and if you are online with us, please feel free to register as well. This is the time when we consider giving back to the church financially. Our church is so blessed with so many talents and gifts, but I was reading this week this phrase that Jesus, it's recorded that Jesus says more than once, "For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also." And I thought that was an interesting twist. Anytime there is a phrase that's recorded where Jesus says it more than once, truthfully, he probably said it many, many times. It was a very important concept that he wanted to get across to his followers. Where your treasure is, there your heart will be. Do you notice the emphasis on where you put your stuff, where you put your time and your talents and your energy? Your heart will follow that. And so I know sometimes we don't feel like giving, or we don't feel like maybe getting up and coming to church, but what Jesus promises is that where you put that energy, where you take that time, where you get out the wallet and you give a little more, your heart will follow that. It's a promise to us today. And so my hope is that today, if this is your church, if this is your community, that you will invest your treasure into the place that you want your heart to be also. So let us receive the morning offering.
One thing that we desire, that as we worship you, Lord, come and change our lives. Arise, 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 arise. Arise, take your place, be enthroned.
I bet on that night that Jesus was to be taken from his disciples, he had music like that. What a joy it is to acknowledge the presence of a living God that comes to us. Last week I was reflecting on that beautiful Bach piece that we had as a part of special music, and this week to have something completely and radically different proves to us just how diverse a church we are. And we come to this moment with our diversity as well. Many of us come from perhaps a Roman Catholic tradition where this communion is about a transubstantiation, that the bread and the cup become the body and the blood of Christ. Others of us come from a more reformed movement where we see this as a meal in memory of Jesus. And other of us come from more Pentecostal traditions where, well, you were lucky if you celebrated communion once a year. But God filled us into this place so that we might celebrate a vibrant church, meeting God wherever we are and bringing our theologies together. Those theologies meet us in this place. When we remember Jesus on the night that he was to be taken from us, he gathered with those disciples. Taking bread from the table, he gave you thanks and praise, and he blessed it, and he broke it, and he passed it to each and every one of them, and he said to them, "Take and eat of this, all of you." Not some of you, all of you. "For this is my body, which is soon to be broken apart for you and for many. Take and eat of this as often as you shall do so, in remembrance of me." And in like fashion, taking from the table a cup which was offered on that Passover meal, he again gave you thanks and praise, and he blessed it. And again he shared it with each and every one of them, and he said to them, "Take and drink of this, all of you. For this is my blood of the new and everlasting covenant that is poured out for you and for many. Take and drink of this as often as you shall do so. But when you do so, remember me," said Jesus.
Let us pray. Holy God, we thank you for your gift of grape and bread, and pray that you would pour out your Holy Spirit on these elements and on us gathered here. Strengthen us through this feast of great grace, and by sharing this feast, may each of us know the presence of the living Christ. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world. Amen.
Amen.
Worship, come forward to prepare a place for you. I remind you that this table belongs to God and has been set for you. It doesn't matter if you're a member of this church or any church, for we understand the sharing of this meal in Jesus' name to represent an ancient vision of God's feast for all peoples. So at the usher's invitation, please come.
Thank you.
God, we thank you for this meal that commemorates the vibrant life of Christ in our midst. May it nourish us into all goodness, and may this vibrant meal encourage us to be the vibrant people of Christ. In the name of Jesus, amen.
Unto God's gracious mercy and protection, each and every one of us is given. And may the blessing of God, known to us as Creator, Savior, and Holy Spirit, be with us and remain with us, now and forevermore. Amen. Go in peace.